The only unexplored sea on the planet is the stretch of Southern Ocean to the east of Tasmania. Is this blank space on the map the location of the Great Southland, theorized by geographers for centuries? In the Europe of 1768, Britannia rules the waves. In science too, the British are at the head of the fleet. Scientific pursuits have become fashionable for men of good breeding. A wealthy young gentleman named Joseph Banks proposes an expedition to the South Pacific. He wants to observe the transit of Venus across the sun, and he wants to look for the Great Southland. Banks puts his own money on the line to buy a ship for the expedition. He chooses a three-masted coal carrier, the Earl of Pembroke. She is converted for the voyage and is renamed the Endeavour. To command her, Banks recruits one of the most respected naval officers in the fleet, Lieutenant James Cook. This partnership produces the best conducted scientific expedition to ever set sail from English shores. The pair successfully observe the transit of Venus. They discover and circumnavigate New Zealand, producing accurate charts and scientific research which will stand for centuries. And then they explore and map the east coast of Australia, the first expedition to ever accurately plot their position in latitude and longitude. So successful was this and later expeditions that Captain James Cook was hailed as one of history's greatest navigators. Joseph Banks' total personal and financial commitment to the voyage make him well credentialed to be considered a father of Australia. And the plucky role played by this stout and sturdy little vessel helps His Majesty's Bark Endeavour claim the title of Australia's flagship. And glorious scenes here at Fishing Boat Harbour in Fremantle. People have literally turned out in their thousands, grabbing any vantage point they can along every available piece of space around the perimeter of this harbour, all here today for one very special lady. The weather's been kind to us too, a cool 15-knot sea breeze, making conditions very comfortable and setting the scene for one of Fremantle's most memorable moments. In just under half an hour, we'll be witnessing one of the truly historic events in this country's history, the launch of His Majesty's Bark Endeavour. Good evening and welcome to viewers right across Perth through Channel 9 and right across Western Australia through GWN. Joining me, the state's leading authority on the Endeavour, the project historian from the WA Maritime Museum, Mike Lefroy. Mike, welcome along.
Hi, Liam.
It is the culmination of 6 years of work. There's a lot at stake here today, some very anxious people. It's very, very exciting, isn't it?
It's sensational. It's interesting, and it's been a very slow build-up over that 6 years. There's been research, there's been sourcing materials, there's even been practicing smashing the bottles. But come the launch, there's no practice.
There is no dress rehearsal.
Absolutely, it didn't slide down last night and was winched up early this morning.
Mike, was there ever any doubt in anybody's mind that this day would ever happen, that we would be here to witness this?
No, we got such a good kick-start from the Bond Corporation, and that 100-foot Jarrah skeleton grew very quickly. It never fitted out the side door, and there's been no other option. Rip the back off the shed and kick it out of the nest.
All right, well, let's find out exactly what is happening on the Endeavour at the moment, up on the decks there. Michael Thompson, what's the feel like?
Well, Liam, it's a feeling of great excitement up here, a feeling of trepidation and nervousness, which is probably quite natural, because with a launch such as this, there obviously is a fair amount of risk. Now, we've just been told by the ship's master, Peter Petrov, of those risks, hence the life jacket, and hence the nervous feeling. But we're all optimistic, we're all confident. We've been told it's a very slight chance that anything could happen, a la a lurch or possibly even the boat taking on huge amounts of water. So we're feeling very positive up here, but it's a wonderful feeling. Most of the people on board the boat, there are 34, including a dog by the name of Buster. Now, he is the bosun's mate dog. The 34 people, most of them are shipwrights, and they are basically emergency teams that will check for leaks. They'll also handle the rigging of the boat. So it's a feeling of great excitement up here. We're really looking forward to it. Must have been, I'll be a little bit happier once we get down onto the water.
Michael, apart from the life jacket, I understand that you're also carrying a knife. Is that right?
Liam, that's true. And it's, again, everyone on board the boat has got to have a life jacket on and instructed to have a knife with them. Now, I have got mine right there. And it's quite simple. When the boat is fully rigged, it has something like 29 kilometres of rope associated with it. So there's a huge amount of rope on the deck right now. If there is a mishap, again, I emphasise it's highly unlikely, we've got to have a rope just to cut ourselves free in case we get tangled up, but that's unlikely to happen. Okay, John McCourt's there on the shore. John, what's it like down there?
Well, thanks, Tomo. Here we are at the stern, and when the Endeavour does slip down the slipway, it'll do so at 11 knots in 11 seconds. And that's the fastest the craft will ever go in its whole lifetime, albeit backwards. And to watch it, a whole bunch of guides that showed literally tens of thousands of Australians and tourists over the Endeavour over the past 5.5 years. And one of those guides is Stan Kimberley. Stan, what's the feeling like right now?
John, if there was a saying of being over Saturn, that's where I'm at the moment.
With regard to the launch, a touch of sadness that it's all over?
It is, yes. I've got to say that. It's just the fact that we've built it up from just a couple of matchsticks.
Terrific. Well, you haven't got long to go. Now let's go over to Dixie Marshall at the bow. Dixie?
Thanks, John. Well, after 6 years, it all comes down to this. Four axemen cutting four ropes and the Endeavour should move. With me is one of those axemen, Brian Phillips. What happens if she doesn't move?
Oh, well, I guess we all go modern then. We've got hydraulics set up, so if we don't cut their ropes, she shouldn't move, we put the hydraulics jacks into action.
Now, there is a secret signal from the master shipwright. Can you tell me what we should be looking for?
Yes, Mr. Bill Leonard will give us a signal to raise our axes with one whistle. Nothing really secret about the whistle. And on the second whistle, we will actually hit the ropes.
Are you ready for this after all this time?
You better believe it.
Excited?
Yes, certainly, yes. Yeah, I've been to a lot of launches, but not as good as this one.
Liam, everybody's pretty toey down here, yeah. So fingers and toes crossed for the next 20 minutes.
Yes, thanks, Dixie. It's an incredible proposition. Just four ropes holding that incredible tonnage in one spot. Mike Lefroy, the concept, it's a bit like an elephant balancing on a pinhead, isn't it?
That's right. Gravity's been the foe for 6 years. The ship's built on its launching angle, 1 in 16. And then suddenly, the ropes are cut and gravity's the ally, and we just sit back and see what happens.
Now, we've seen just a few minutes ago that the boat actually has moved in the last 24 hours.
That's right. We walked past, we saw the telltales, two pieces of wood, were originally put tight together like that, and now there's a gap in between. So that ship's alive. It's ready to go.
So we're keeping our fingers crossed.
Absolutely.
Right, let's put the launch of the Endeavour into some sort of perspective for you, and let's see how the whole concept of this incredible feat came about.
Dennis Collar, Stars and Stripes, 87, winning the America's Cup.
In the bittersweet summer of 1987, Bruce Stannard saw his close friend Dennis Connor sail off with the America's Cup. The magazine journalist and television reporter filed his last story from Fremantle and returned to Sydney. As a council member of the National Maritime Museum, Stannard was asked for ideas for a showpiece exhibit at the Darling Harbour site. His suggestion was breathtaking. Build a full-scale sailing replica of Captain Cook's Endeavour. Even with years of experience as a yachting writer, Stannard could barely have imagined the intricacies of such an ambitious project.
If you're a true believer, and you have to be with a project like this, you just put a pair of blinkers on and you focus and you stay focused. And that's what I've done for the past 8 years, you know. Conceived the idea for the project and stuck at it.
Stannard approached Alan Bond to bankroll the project, and the entrepreneur, still a high-flying corporate hero, agreed. Bond convinced fellow board members of Bond Corporation to pledge a $10 million gift to the nation. In October 1988, the keel was laid and building began in earnest to recreate, plank by plank, an exact copy of the original ship. But if the replica Endeavour was to be able to fulfil her role as a fully functional sailing vessel, there would have to be some additions to the original.
We don't live in the 18th century. There is a requirement to make sure that people don't get scurvy and eat properly. And therefore, starting from aft, in what was the ship's breadroom, we have fitted some freezers. And obviously, from a safety point of view, we have got to ensure that we have the fallback situation that if push comes to shove, we can turn on the engines and get out of there.
And instead of the traditional English timbers of elm, oak and spruce, Western Australian Jarrah hardwood was chosen to guarantee the Endeavour a long life afloat. Large pieces of Jarrah were specially milled for the project, and skilled shipwrights, adept at shaping timber ships, were recruited. This closely knit team has produced a ship so finely crafted she exceeds the standards of any wooden shipyard in the world.
I think it's probably the most remarkable project I've ever seen. And without doubt, I believe she is the best replica ship that's ever been built in the world. I say that almost without hesitation.
The sails and rigging prepared for Endeavour's three masts are faithful copies of the originals. And although they are produced from modern materials, they're designed to have the look and feel of the originals. The catchphrase of the whole building project has been, "Nothing is too good for this ship."
Yes, and thousands of people hoping and praying for a smooth launch for the Endeavour here at Fremantle this afternoon. Of course, there is a lot that can go wrong. We'll be back after this break to discuss the possibilities. And welcome back to the launch of the Endeavour. It is literally ticking away now, the minutes going by very, very quickly. In fact, probably all too quickly for many, many people down here. The tension really is building and the atmosphere is just fantastic with thousands of West Australians, as you can see, they're turning out to witness this very historic event. In fact, we're just talking Mike Lefroy, the stern of the ship, it's just sitting up there, isn't it? Proud as punch, looks absolutely majestic.
Yes, I can't wait to see the rest of it. But it's interesting, when people have come through the project, they've looked at the colours and they've said, well, you know, surely that's too gaudy. It looks a bit like Mick Malthouse and the boys came and did a paint job celebrating an Eagles victory.
We can see the stern there now. It's very, very bright colours,
isn't it? It is, isn't it? But one of the great things about this project, it's an international project. We've had the resources of the National Maritime Museum in Greenwich, and they've been able to send us information. They have ship models there painted in the 18th century in the correct livery of the time, and we've been able to use that and to recreate these colours. The difference being, and this is part of the philosophy, there's Mary Whitby, that's one of the carvings Jenny Scrane has done on the stern of the ship. But one of the advantages we have is that we're using modern paints, one of the things that Cook didn't have. So this will last a long time. What you see is what you'll get for a long, long time.
So this is as close as we can get to the 18th century edition.
That's correct, yes.
All right, Mike, apart from the paint, of course, there were and have been many more problems, much more monumental in size. To talk about them now, John McCourt.
Thanks, Liam. Well, we're about 15 minutes away from the launch and the end of the magnificent project. But it's a project which was nearly scuttled as it lurched from one financial crisis to the next. And if it wasn't for the likes of John Longley, it probably would never have happened. Let's take a look back.
When project originator Bruce Stannard first suggested the idea of building the Endeavour replica, fellow board members of the National Maritime Museum were enthusiastic.
Wonderful idea, a great idea, but you go out and raise the money for it. I was patted on the head. I was 8 years younger, and all my colleagues on the council sent me out to raise the money. Now, you go and do it all yourself. Well, I've done that by and large, and I think that it's been well worth the effort.
Stannard's first stop in seeking the money was obvious. As a specialist sailing writer, he'd just spent much of the America's Cup summer with Alan Bond. The entrepreneur managed to convince the board of Bond Corporation to bankroll the project, despite the calamity of the 1987 stock market crash. Just 7 months after the building had begun in earnest, Boncorp's bravado was extinguished by financial reality. It was broke and it had to sell off the infant project. Project manager John Longley managed to convince the Japanese Yoshiya Corporation to take it over. But shortly afterwards, the growing international recession forced the Japanese to also withdraw. With the project facing total disaster, Longley soldiered on. Unpaid, but with a dogged determination to see it through.
Well, basically, I'm a stubborn person, and I spent 3 years of my life at that stage on the Endeavour, and I didn't want to walk away from it. We had already started to, you know, feel that the ship was a person, and all of those silly emotional reasons.
With the support of sponsors, Longley and Stannard sought government funding for the project. The man who masterminded Britain's bicentennial gift to Australia, the sail training ship Young Endeavour, had an idea. Englishman Arthur Weller suggested the setting up of a charitable foundation. The support of the Western Australian public and tourists from overseas and interstate now became crucial. A team of volunteer guides showed visitors through the ship. They came in their hundreds, then their thousands. Each small donation and every souvenir purchased
inching the project toward completion.
A lot of people talk about whether it was Bond Corporation or the Japanese or the foundation or whether it was the government money. In the end, there was one, we maybe could have survived without some of those. We could have never done it without the volunteer guides.
Then, once again, the project was becalmed by bankruptcy. The Endeavour looked dead in the water, but those who had toiled on the project for so long refused to be laid off, working for a third of normal pay till government funding came through.
It's the magic of the project. It's only once in a lifetime you get this sort of a chance, and I think we all know that. For this reason, everybody's put their very best into it, and the result is there for everybody to see. It's magic.
It was finally two massive personal donations which set the Endeavour sailing toward completion. British food magnate Gary Weston fell in love with the ship and wrote a personal cheque for £500,000. Then Aussie advertising guru John Singleton put his hand in his pocket for $1 million. The Endeavour had weathered the storm.
Yes, it's been a long, hard road, and another Australian company very much involved at the pointy end of the ship, Mike, the Penfolds Company. Look at that, a bottle of good old Grange Hermitage, and that bottle is all set up to be used, well, smashed, really, which is a bit of a shame. It is a magnum.
It is a great shame, but beautiful, it's going to a very good purpose.
Why aren't they using champagne, as in traditional launches?
Well, we're back in the 18th century. Champagne wasn't around. Of course, champagne belonged to the French, and they're the enemy.
Right.
So the wine was the reason.
All right, we look forward to seeing that literally smashed on the bow by Professor Adrian Clark from the CSIRO.
Looking forward to that.
There are thousands of people down here at Fremantle, and you can see on that shot the North Mole anxiously waiting for the big launch. We'll be back in just a moment. That is an amazing sight. Look at that. Mike, His Majesty's Bark Endeavour, the replica, the true, authentic working model. That's an incredible sight, isn't it?
What a smooth launching, Liam. And do you notice the Marine and Harbour's chasing after? I think they're going to put a speeding ticket on her. It's an 8-knot area, and she went in at 11.
Mike, why do you think it was launched early? We had to come back out of that commercial break and crash into the launch, just missing the bottle being smashed on the bow there as we were talking. But we're about 7 or 8 minutes by schedule early. Why do you think that is?
It could have been the ship was skidding so lively. There is a case in England of when the launching party went actually up on the platform, and the master shipwright saw the ship on the move, grabbed the bottle of port, took a swig, chucked the bottle after the departing vessel, and said, "God bless," and off it went. The launching party weren't even there. I mean, it's a very good example. The ship launches itself when it's ready, not when we're ready, and I think that could be the reason.
It certainly sounds like it. The tugs there are moving into position. That is sitting, I mean, to me as a layman, it looks like it's sitting absolutely beautifully in the water.
Yes, she's sitting high. She's meant to be that high. She's only got 40 tons of ballast on. Another 120 goes on when she sails. The inclination tests will be done tomorrow and next week, but it looks absolutely perfect. There's the underwater shot, look at that. And at this stage, there'll be a diver going down. The poppets, which form part of the cradle, they have to be cut away so that the ship can be taken to tow. What's happening at the moment is the tug is holding it up to windward. The stern is held up to windward, and you can see it there. When everything is clear, the master attendant, Peter Petroff, on deck, he will be checking down below, checking there's no leaks. What we should look for...
Let's go, Mike, let's go right now, in fact, to the deck. And Michael Thompson, what is happening?
Well, Liam, I have got the ship's master right with me now, Peter Petroff, and Peter's been getting information from... Is it all clear there?
All clear down below, yeah.
All clear below. Peter, just tell us basically what's happened and what's the story so far.
Okay, we've launched the ship. We came down the ways. Fantastic, no problems. We've gone down below to test our watertight integrity, and we seem to be fine there. The pilot, Roger Petman, is now taking the tow with the tugs, so we're just going to hold her in position. Our next step now is to release the poppets, which are the cradle, if you like, she came down the ways with. But the first step is to get it in control position with the tugs. And then we release the poppets, and then we look forward to a tow around to the main harbour.
Now, you've been involved with the whole project for 6 years now, right from the start. You've probably had that launch go through your mind 1,000 times. It seemed to just go perfectly. It was as smooth as silk.
Well, I think it's credit to everybody involved. There's been a lot of people involved in this project, and for something like this to go as smoothly as it has so far, touch wood, it's a credit to everybody involved, yes.
Peter, just basically, is there anyone else you need to talk to now, or are you pretty well satisfied that everything's gone perfectly according to plan and that she's going to be no problems to be towed around?
No, we're obviously so far so good. We're going to get in the position where she's stable. We're going to have the poppets removed. But there's always a vigilant. We must always be looking around, making sure nothing's untoward's going to happen from now on.
I just heard Liam and Mike talking before. The launch was some 7 minutes early. Do you know why that was? Was the boat starting to move?
No, I think that, we have a timetable, but if we're 5 minutes early, we're 5 minutes early. It's a bit like a birthday, it comes when it's ready.
Okay, so you must be absolutely delighted. It must be a great feeling for you.
Yes, so far so good, and yes, I'm absolutely delighted. Thank you.
Peter Petroff, a very happy man. Liam, the feeling up here is great. As we came down the slip, and it really was as smooth as silk, no bumps, no jumps, the crew and the shipwrights, they were all chanting and cheering as we went down and shaking their fists in the air. There was lots of hugging. It really was a great feeling, and it's a privilege for all of us on the boat to be involved in something as historic as this.
You can, Michael, I don't know whether you can grab Peter Petroff again. What is exactly the situation on the leakage? Will they be checking that as we speak and for some time or not?
Liam, actually, yes. They have already checked most of the areas for the leaks, and so far there are no major leaks at all. In fact, there's very little water coming in. So at the moment, it's all thumbs up from here on the boat. They're delighted with the progress so far. And as I said earlier, lots of hugging and fish being thrown in the air. It's a sheer delight because it's been 6 years of very, very hard work.
Michael, how stable is it underfoot for you? Can you feel the boat moving at all?
Well, Liam, it's so big, and I mean, it's such a vast ship that no, it really is smooth. In fact, when we hit the water, I expected to feel a great lurch forward, but there was nothing. It was as if we just slid down and almost like on ice and felt nothing at all. There was nothing, no bumps. And she feels as solid as a rock. We're not moving at all. It's a very steady platform.
Mike, I know you only have about 35 or 40 people on board now. Can you imagine, can you picture what it's like in your own mind standing there on the deck to what it must have been like for James Cook with something like 94 people on board, exactly the same size vessel?
Well, Liam, that's it. I mean, we're sort of thinking about the conditions on board this boat. And as I said earlier, with all the rope on board the vessel, plus... all of the men, such a crew of in excess of 60, the space was just so tight. And it's probably a good time now to maybe look back and just have a look at what the conditions were like underneath the Endeavour when she was sailing.
Michael, we'll go to that in a moment. It just looks absolutely superb. We're looking at an aerial shot now
right.
From the helicopter, and it not to mention the fact that it dwarfs most of the other vessels, but just the majestic way. I know that's a bit of a cliche, but it really does look majestic. Mike Lefroy, would you agree with that?
Yes, just looking at the ensign there, that ensign, the 1606 ensign, flying there proudly at the stern of the ship. It really is a magnificent sight, and it looks like that the tugs are moving.
Just hang on, just in case.
More quickly into position than we thought. It's been such a smooth operation.
All right, Dixie Marshall is in fact talking to the man who made all this possible now, Mike, John Longley. Let's go to Dixie. Dixie?
John Longley, the man they call Mr. Endeavour. 6 years of your life, John. Are you relieved?
I've lost my voice.
Tell me what was going through your mind.
Yeah, look, I'm 75. It all happened so quickly. We knew she wanted out of there because she'd moved that much already. And then chop, bang, wham, and whooshka.
And she's in and she's safe.
3 cheers and I've blown my voice. Well, hopefully. We got her there now. We've got a lot of work to do. We've got to get the poppets off her. We've got to get make sure that she's not taking a lot of water, but I'm going to find that out real soon. I'm really not quite sure what's going on board the boat at the moment. But so far, so good. And it's great because she's floating right on the lines too. I know exactly how much she should be out of the water. We've still got to put 110 tons of Mr. Pazminko's lead in there to get her down to come right. But it looks like it's going to be spot on.
Tell me about your team. I know I've heard you call them your family.
Well, look what they did. Look what they did.
Look at them,
eh? Oh, I am so proud of them. They are an incredible team of people. I mean, it got to the stage where I was wandering around the other day like a lost soul because I didn't have to do anything. It was all happening. And I kept saying, you know, is this organized? Is this ready? Go away, John. Yes.
What would
Carl
you...
out there, Carl had 2 hours sleep last night.
And then, did you see him go down, though, with his hands up in the air?
No, I didn't.
He's a baby.
Oh, God. Yeah.
What would you say to the people of Australia, John? I mean, I heard John Houston say earlier in the week that it allows us to look back on our past with pride and not guilt. What would you say to the people of Australia to get behind this endeavour?
Well, I'll tell you what I'll say. That ship was built by Australians, and it was built by... what Australia's all about. 50% maybe of people who were born here, 50% of people who came in, and you know, we've got such wealth of talent, we can do anything. God, we just did this. And that's, if it's only a symbol of that, and of course it will be a symbol of so many other things, but it's only a symbol of the fact that we can do anything. Well, then it's been worth it all.
We're very proud of you. Congratulations.
Thanks,
John
very
Longley.
Much.
Back to you, Liam.
Yes. Thanks, Dixie. Well, it is a very proud moment. Look at that, Mike Lefroy. I mean, they talk about it being perhaps a national icon. It certainly looks like a national icon sitting there in the water, doesn't it?
It sure does, yeah. What we're looking for now, Liam, is that the extempore masts, these are temporary masts to be raised, and the flags to be raised on those masts, and that is the sign that the ship is squared away and ready to be towed.
Now, they're still obviously keeping that, keeping it pointed in the right direction.
Yes. I was speaking to Peter earlier this afternoon. He said it could take half an hour to clear the poppets. A diver needed to go down. There's a brace underneath that needs to be cut. I think looking at the bow of the ship there, we've got our diver. One of the amazing things, as this, did you feel our commentary position, did you feel the surge of water come underneath us?
Yes, it was
as
amazing.
As the ship went past, yeah.
It was, but it was so smooth, it was hard to believe. As Michael Thompson pointed out from the deck, it felt that way just turning around and looking at it. The noise you just heard in the background, the volley of muskets from the heritage people, it's very appropriate, isn't it?
Yes, that's the West Australian Muzzleloader Society. We actually had them before we had a breakfast on board the ship, and we had them firing inside the shed, and it's just amazing. Our ears are still ringing from that.
Mike, obviously, as John Longley says, that boat will sit lower in the water once that extra ballast has been added.
Correct.
It might be opportune now to mention the white paint on the underbelly. How many coats on that?
There's between 8 and 10 coats. It's very clever. This is one of the philosophies of the project, is it's visually it's 18th century, but cocooned in there is the 20th century insurance policy. That paint is, the final coat is a self-polishing anti-fouling, and what happens is that as it wears out, as it loses its grip, the anti-fouling, the other colours start to show through. It's a bit like those toothbrushes where it has a coloured piece in the middle, and when the colour wears out, you chuck them away.
It lets you know to get a new toothbrush.
That's right. It says, ring, ring, time to anti-foul. Because one of the problems that Cook had with these ships coming to tropical waters, the Limnora and the Teredo worms, oak caviar to them, they loved it. And so they'd chew away. They had to put a sacrificial skin around the outside. And the idea that the worms would eat that and leave the rest of the ship to them. They didn't have the modern paints and preservatives that we have.
Fantastic. Well, there it is, and in the words of the great philosophers, so far, so good. We'll be back at the Endeavour launch in just a moment. And welcome back to Fremantle, the safe launch of the Endeavour, His Majesty's Bark Endeavour. It was an amazing moment. Let's just try and have a look now at Mike Lefroy at some of the replays of that launch and just have a good look at exactly how that ship. There's Professor Adrian Clark from the CSIRO. The Grange Hermitage did well.
That's Freddie Milner, who in fact, his name is the same name as the original owner of the ship, so it's most appropriate. He should be cutting the...
It's ironic, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. It's lovely.
And look at it slide into the water. That is amazing, yeah. Isn't it?
There was a feeling that it could bounce, it could kick, it could do anything. It's just so smooth.
Shot from the deck, understandably jubilant.
And there's Nick Truelove I saw there, it's a hand in the air. Yeah, she pushes a bit of water going backwards.
Yes, there's...
Carl.
That's live as we
and
speak,
and that's
Mike.
Billy Leonard, our master shipwright, technical director. Carl, John Owen, Albert, they're all there.
We're very, very
Bill's
happy.
Going down just to make sure nothing's coming through. There's Nick. Nick was the one that fitted out the great cabin. Did a lot of the work in the great cabin.
There it is again, Mike, as it goes down the slipway into the ocean for the very first time. 6 years of work, more than 20 shipwrights and craftspeople, $16.2 million. It's hard to believe that that's what you're seeing in one vessel, but nevertheless, if you consider all the work that's been done, all the materials. They say that, of course, you know, we would never get the chance to see that site. We've certainly never seen it in Australia before, and probably in our lifetimes we'll never again. It's an amazing thing to witness, isn't it?
That is. It looks like we've come back to the cutting away of the poppets. There's Rob Hartley, Buster's owner, and they're cutting away the ropes that'll hold the poppets, and then the Navy workboats will come and tow them away.
Now, Mike, is this another good sign that everything's going well?
Oh, this is great. Yeah, it means that the ship is sound and the next stage can commence.
Which is the towing.
The towing round to Victoria Quay, that's right.
Now the ship goes to Victoria Quay and is what? Fitted out then?
That's right. It'll be fitted out. It'll be open again to the public from the 19th of December, and the fit out will then be followed by trial sailing, because it's too dangerous to really for us 20th century sailors before we're used to it to sail it to Sydney in the winter. So waiting for that October period when the last of the Westerlies come and the ship can sail around to Sydney.
Well, Mike, I'm sure the thousands of West Australians who have turned up to have a look at this launch have not been disappointed.
No, I think most people got a very good vantage too and of watching this magnificent event.
It's quite easy, isn't it, to imagine the masts and it being basically fully rigged when you look at it like that, especially from the aerial shot of sitting in the water.
Wouldn't it be magnificent to see it now, just haul up sails and sail away? But there's a lot of work to do, and that'll be carried out at Victoria Quay. All the masts, it's all prefabricated, the rig, the ship will go down there and the rig will come on board and the ship will be prepared for sea.
Right, let's go back on board now, onto the deck, and Michael Thompson.
Yes, Liam, great scenes up here. Bill Leonard is just coming to congratulate Peter Petrov, and both men delighted with what's happened so far. Only a trickle of water has been coming inside the boat, and I mean that, an absolute trickle. The poppets have just been cut and they have been released from the boat, so everything has been going superbly on here. In fact, if you'll pardon the cliche, without a hitch. And I might just grab Bill Leonard if I can. Bill, if he's got 2 seconds, I might drag you away for a bit. This must be a great feeling for you.
Oh, it's a wonderful feeling for me. It's nice to get aboard the ship again, actually. I mean, it's terrifying. I mean, under the ship, you've got to launch a blinking thing, you see, and there's been, a lot of nervous energy has been expanded today. And it's just nice to get aboard the ship and see the guys again, and knowing that, we've done it and the ship's afloat and she's good, she's perfectly dry. And it's just sort of, just the whole perspective, of course, is different. In the ship, you're lying at a thing called declivity, which is an angle of 16 to 1, and now we're level. So now we can actually see the ship. It's really tremendous. I feel very happy.
I was saying to Peter earlier on, he must have sort of done the launch in his mind probably 1,000 times. You've probably done the same thing. Uh-huh. Did you imagine it would go so well, so smoothly?
Yeah, really. I mean, it's a wonderful ship, right? It's built the cradles. We built the launchways, and it was checked out pretty thoroughly by by appropriate naval architects, and we got it all together in the moment, and it happened. It was a wonderful sight.
It's a great deal of emotion here, and obviously we've been on board the boat. It's hard for us to get a perspective. You said it is a different perspective. Mm-hmm. For us, it must be a great sight actually seeing it in the water. And I mean, no one has seen it from a distance.
Yeah, she's really cute. I always thought that the stern was prettiest and the bow was okay, but no, just the whole thing's just beautiful. It's wonderful, absolutely wonderful.
Okay, and now we're going to we'll get her in tow, and we shall take her around to Victoria Key, and she'll actually start to be moving through the water. So again, another a milestone in this very short career so far of HMS Endeavour. Liam, let's go back to you.
Yes, good on you, Michael. It looks like there's smiles all around there, definitely, Mike. Very, very happy. What are those, the masts we just saw in the background? It's not a mast, is it, as such?
No, they're temporary masts. They're stunsail booms, which are for extra sails on the ship. And they'll be put up to put up the flags. We'll see the jack at the bow of the ship go up, then the New South Wales state flag, the Australian national flag on the mainmast, the West Australian flag, and, of course, the red ensign.
All right, Michael, let's have another replay for those people who may have missed it. Or just for anybody who's enjoying it, because I know
that's
we are.
That's a great shot, yes.
Look at that, coming out of the back of that shed. That's amazing, isn't it? The red ensign, the launch flag at the back there, flying in full gusto.
And just the speed of the ship, that really is as fast as it'll go. The ship averaged round about 3.5 knots. And to put that in perspective, Kieran Perkins, when he swims at 1,500 metre record pace, swims at 3.4 knots. So that's about the same speed as the average speed of the Endeavour in moderate airs.
That's not very fast. It's the original slow boat to China, isn't it?
One of the advantages of the ship, as a survey ship, a slow ship means mapping and sounding, all that sort of thing can be carried out very easily.
I think it's one of the things perhaps that people tend to ignore. Cook was one of the greatest navigators of the world, wasn't he? He's ranked up there with Vasco da Gama and Magellan.
He's way up. He was fortunate in a way to come at a time when navigators were starting to look up for their information, because navigation from the stars was becoming much more accurate. But he was really the first navigator to know exactly where he was on Earth.
That line has been attached there. Does that mean the towing is imminent?
That's a good sign. We're still being held up into the breeze. What we're looking for is for the tug to move to the bow so that the towing can commence. He's just still being held up to the breeze. The poppets and the makeup, that's the stuff in between, this lovely language, this 18th century language. Makeup is the stuff in between the poppets. Thick stuff with thick bits of wood. They were very logical people then.
Some of the nautical language from that time, it was fairly straightforward, wasn't it?
Oh, yes. My favourite, the tree nails. You know, if you want a nail made from wood, it's a nail made from a tree nail, and they used to run that together, the trunnels.
Now, that's an interesting point, Mike. There are no metal nails in this vessel, is there?
Well, there is under the water, because that's one of the trade-offs. Under the water, they're double-dip galvanised coach screws, but that's all covered up. That's all covered up, and we're pretty sure the fish aren't too concerned about the accuracy there. But above, what we want to make sure the top sides look real, and when you look at them, you see the ends of the trunnels, you see the little wedges, and incidentally, these wedges, 3,000 of the trunnels throughout the ship, we've given some of the school kids that have come through the project, and some of them may be watching today, they've come through the project and they've written their names on these wedges and some little messages like South Fremantle for Premiers 1996 or something like that. They've gone into the ship, and what we're hoping in 400, 500 years' time, some maritime archaeologist will be looking at these decaying bits of wood and have a real query to solve. Who was South Fremantle and why did they win the premiership and so on.
Terrific. Yeah. All right, Mike. Well, the launch has gone according to plan so far. We'll be back here at Fremantle in just a moment. Welcome back to Fremantle and the Endeavour, sitting very, very nicely in the water after its successful launch. Taking a little bit longer than we anticipated, though, to get away under tow into around the corner, of course, into Victoria Key, the inner harbour. Let's find out why. Michael Thompson's on board. Michael.
Yes, thanks very much, Liam. Well, Peter is with me once again, and Peter, we had some sort of a problem with the poppets. You believe that there was a reason why we were sitting so steadily in the water?
I feel we're very close to the bottom, and the poppets actually protrude the bottom of the hull, so they may have been just on the bottom of the bottom and just a little bit stubborn to get away. We've now cleared them, and our next step, of course, is to take the forward tug, tow line to the forward tug, and go out of the harbour.
Now, have there been any other problems in the last 5 or so minutes? I know Bill was just saying something about a rope being tangled. Is that anything to worry about?
No, nothing serious. We're just now trying to clear these poppets, and there's the lines in the water and so forth. A couple of lines just a little bit tangled up. We just need to sort of clear that so they can get them well clear of a ship before we start to tow.
Okay, so once all that's clear, we shall then see the flags going up on the small mast?
Yes, that's a sign to everybody around us to say that the ship is now basically sound. There's watertight integrity. There's no water coming in. And we've released the poppets, we're ready for the tow. So we'll hoist the mast, the flags on the mast when we're ready, and that will be a signal that we're all ready to go.
Okay, thanks very much, Peter. Look, Liam, everything going so well up here, everyone's feeling so good, and it really has been a perfect launch for the Endeavour. It's back to you.
Yes, thanks, Michael. And I know that people are disappointed in the main that we'll be leaving Fremantle and WA, but Mike Lefroy, despite the fact that it will be sailing to Sydney, a lot of Fremantle ghosts on board, aren't there?
Oh, that's quite right, Liam. Yes, the timber, for instance, oak wasn't used. What was chosen was West Australian jarrah. And in fact, jarrah is a superior timber. It's more stubborn for the worms to attack.
Good old WA jarrah.
Oh, that's right. In fact, from the very early days, the Success found a little lumpy spot off Karnak Island and had to be repaired. She was careened at Garden Island and repaired with jarrah. And when she was taken back to England, the shipwrights in England were very impressed with this Swan River mahogany, as it was called. So it's got quite a history as a shipbuilding timber, and big jetties down south. It's done its job, and we were very confident all the way along that it was the right timber for Endeavour.
What other bits and pieces on board are there from WA peculiarly?
I think one of the nicest stories is the a lot of the large pieces of wood. We're looking back at the ship here now, and the belfry, that's the gallows just coming in, and the belfry, that's the curved part, the bell hangs in that. They come from the Hotham Valley Road Bridge, which is a 70-year-old, beautiful, seasoned jarrah, and luckily, thanks to the Main Roads Department, we were able to get hold of that, because these large, seasoned lumps of jarrah were very necessary for an accurate reconstruction. A replica of Cook's ship.
All right, Mike, we'll be back in just a moment to talk about more. It's looks as though it is being moved.
Yes, it looks like the bow line is on and the ship is slowly swinging. Yep.
It's certainly in preparation there, isn't it?
The poppets being towed away on the top of your screen there. You can see the poppets. That's the Air Sea Rescue Orange for the forward poppets, and it's being towed down to what we call the Sardine Wharf near the ship shed. That's towed right away so it won't damage any other boats.
All right, Mike, we'll take a quick break and we'll come back and hopefully see a bit more movement. And back at Fremantle. Still at Fishing Boat Harbour, of course, waiting for the Endeavour, His Majesty's Bark Endeavour, the replica, the authentic replica, certainly not a Disney World piece, is it? It's definitely a working ship. It looks like
not a ship sitting in the water. Even down below, the module, the 20th century module, can be removed when it's in museum state later on when its sailing life is finished. So it's built very strictly to the standards of the 18th century.
Mike, we're running out of time. Where can people go to see the Endeavour before it sails off to Sydney?
Well, the ship's going to be slowly towed around. There'll be a week or so setting it up, but then from the 19th of December, it'll be open again to the public down at Victoria Quay, and they can enter through the West Australian Maritime Museum's historic boat shed, and they can have a look at the displays of the Endeavour.
And where can some of the school children particularly, get some information?
Well, there's some very interesting project material available.
We can hold that up right now. In fact, Mike, if we can get a shot of that, we can see the school project, Captain Cook.
Yes, there's some very some excellent project material available. And there's also a kit here that's available from the Endeavour shop, which will be set up once again on Victoria Quay.
Fabulous.
And that's got lots of information about the original voyage
thousands
and about the replica.
Thousands of school children will be very, very happy. Well, Mike, that's all we have time for from here at Fremantle. course, news is coming up next here on Nine. Thanks very much for your company. It's been a fantastically successful launch, and everyone very, very happy. Michael Froy, thanks very much for joining us.
A pleasure, Liam.